Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
We are broadcasting
live from Tooele, Utah.
Downtown.
Well, I hope everybody had a really good week. I hope everything went good for you. But if you're like me, I look forward to this day every single week. Regardless of how good a week I do, and especially if I don't have such a good week, this is a special time. You know why? Because I love all y'all, and I get to be with you. And so it's a great day for me.
I thought you were going to say, because this is a day that Yah made, and I will rejoice and be glad.
That too. But I'm here with all of you, and Yahweh is right here in our midst. And so it is especially a good day. Amen. And it's good to see your smiling faces. Everybody is smiling, aren't they? All right. I'm going to back up here. I didn't realize I put those at the front. What I'm going to show you now and share with you has absolutely nothing to do with the teaching today. It's just something that caught my interest, and I wanted to share it with all of you. When I was going through seminary, I had to write a thesis, an essay, on all of the early church fathers. And I had to give my own opinion of each one of the early church fathers. And because of all of the things that I had been taught, I was like everybody else. I thought the early church fathers were these really knowledgeable people, and they were right on and so forth. One thing you'll notice as I show you what I'm about to show you is some of these people were not far removed from Yeshua's earthly ministry, and especially from the destruction of the temple. Some of them were only a few years after that. I'm 75 years old. Some of them weren't even 70 years after that. And so some of these knew some of the biblical figures that we would talk about as we teach. So it's a very interesting thing, but I just wanted to bring this to your attention because I want you to see the truth. Now, the religious system does not show you what I'm about to show you because they lift these people in high esteem. And so I want you to be aware. Some quotes from the church fathers. Ignatius, Bishop of Antioch. You notice when he lived? 98 AD. How long is that after the destruction of the temple? Not very long. I mean, there's an epistle that he wrote. I want you to look at the words that he wrote in his epistle. For if we are still practicing Judaism, we admit that we have not received God's favor. It is wrong to talk about Jesus Christ and live like Jews. For Christianity did not believe in Judaism, but Judaism in Christianity.
Right.
This is from one of the early church fathers that the religious system holds in high esteem, really looks up to. Here's another one, the Epistle of Barnabas. Notice when it was, 130 AD. That's only, what, like 60 years after the destruction of the temple. He says, take heed to yourselves, and be not like some piling up your sins, and saying that the covenant is theirs as well as ours. It is ours, but they lost it completely just after Moses received it.
What shall we mean by the spirit of the anti-Messiah was already done?
Amen.
Good.
Here's another one from Justin Martyr. You may recognize some of these names from your days in the religious system. We too would observe your circumcision of the flesh, your Sabbath days, and in a word, all of your festivals, If we were not aware of the reason why they were imposed on you, namely because of your sins and the hardness of your heart.
Oh, aren't you glad we don't have people like that today?
Maybe.
Yeah, right.
Here is the golden mouth. If you pay attention to this, highly revered in the religious system. Look what he says. The synagogue is worse than a brothel.
Oh, my God.
It is the den of scoundrels and the repair of wild beasts, the temple of demons devoted to idolatrous cults, the refuge of brigands and debauchees, and the cavern of devils.
Wow.
It is a criminal assembly of Jews, a place of meeting for the assassins of Christ, a house worse than a drinking shop, a den of thieves, a house of ill fame, a dwelling of iniquity, the refuge of devils, a gulf and an abyss of perdition. I would say the same things about their souls. As for me, I hate the synagogue. I hate the Jews for the same reason.
Sounds like
that's a perfect example of loving thy brother.
He just hates everything.
Well, guess what? Unless he repented before he left this earth, he's a cursed man.
Yep.
That's what I have taught all of you, that they were cursed.
Yep.
Yahweh says, if you curse my people Israel,
I curse you. Mm-hmm.
I curse you. So you judge for yourself. Today I wanted to talk with you about Shemot, and I have titled it, Yahweh Speaks with Moshe. You know, I think some of the greatest times of our lives is when we decide to just be still and know that He's Elohim and listen to His small, still voice. Listen as He guides us through the words of the Torah, how He speaks truth to us, and how He reveals lies, half-truths, completes falsehoods. To hear that little rumbling in my spirit means a great deal to me. And I can only imagine what it must have been like for Moshe to actually speak to Him. To actually hear Him, not in that small, still voice that we hear, but in the thunderings from Sinai. In the times He spoke with Moshe. By the way, He just spoke with us today in the reading of His Tanakh and speaks to us now from the Torah in the book of Shemot. Did you notice something I caught next to the very last verse in today's reading of Yirmiyahu 43? Did you notice that He identified a problem then that is a problem now?
Mm-hmm.
And that is with interpreters. Did you catch that as it was read today? That is a major problem. There are Christians, bless their heart, who still really honestly believe that He spoke English. They do. Although English wasn't even a language then. But it's hard to convince some people, isn't it? Let's look. Shemot 31:1. And Yahweh spoke to Moshe, saying, I've talked many times on the word spoke here. By now we're acutely aware that it means Dvar, a careful arrangement of words. But we have to remember again that while He spoke words to Moshe, let's not forget also that words are made up of letters. And so what we are seeing here, when it talks about a careful arrangement, Yahweh is very careful about what letters He uses to form words. Because as I taught you in an earlier teaching, choose the wrong letter and you change the whole meaning of the word. One letter can alter the whole meaning. So we begin to grasp why it is so important that we know the Hebrew. How many of you ever heard of Danny Ben Gigi? Anybody ever heard of him? He's supposed to be an expert in the Hebrew language. And as near as I can tell, he is. I love to hear him speak about the Hebrew language. He shared something that I wanted to share with you because it kind of touched my heart. He said, it's a great thing to pray. It's a good thing to pray in English or Spanish or German or whatever language you speak. But he said, if you take that same prayer and put it in Hebrew, you will find that it means a lot more. That isn't to say that Yahweh doesn't understand if I pray in Spanish or German or English. But it does mean that that is His language. Israel is His chosen people and Hebrew is His chosen language. Can you imagine how much more He desires to hear it spoken in His tongue? So I think that we really do need to learn how to transliterate. Even if you don't, it's like Danny Ben Gigi says, you transliterate it into the Hebrew, you may not even know what you're saying. But you can learn to read transliterated Hebrew. We've seen that here. Even though you don't know what it means, if you'll just read it, He knows what it means. And so I would encourage all of us to do exactly that. Dabar is a primitive root and is in the verb form. Now, why did I put that up there? Why is it necessary that we know that it is a verb? Because it's an action word. Because whatever Yahweh speaks is action. Nothing that leaves the mouth of Yahweh is just something to be heard. It's something to be done. And He arranges it that way. So that we understand when we hear it, we are to do it. Be not hearers of the word only, but be you doers of the word. So the arrangement is very careful and is intended. When we hear it, we will have the desire to do it. We don't come here and just hear a teaching. We come here and hear the teaching, apply it to our lives and live it out. This is the idea. Yahweh selectively chose the letters from the alphabet, the alphabet, and formed words in order to create things. You remember? He created everything from the alphabet. Here's an example. If I look at those letters, what's the top letter? Everybody should be, by now, know the Hebrew letters. Okay? We have a dalet at the top, and that dalet means to enter or open a path or a way. If I look at the next letter, it is a bet. It means a house or a family. The next letter is what?
Resh.
Resh means first, beginning, or head. Now, let me give you an example here. If I look at the top letter and the bottom letter, if I'm not very careful when I'm writing Hebrew or reading Hebrew, and I transpose those two letters, I could create a problem. Because they look very much alike. But look carefully because they are not alike. They are different. Slightly different, but different. What this means, if I take those words which mean davar, means the head of the house opens a path or way. So when He spoke to Moshe, what is He doing? He's opening a path or a way. He's speaking through Moshe the Torah in order to give direction, right? And to open a pathway so that Moshe knows exactly what he's supposed to do, right?
A way of understanding.
Absolutely. This word can also carry other meanings. It can mean other things, as Hebrew often does. It can mean to set in a row, arrange in order, to lead or guide a flock to pasture, to bring into order, to rule or lead. Every one of those meanings has to do with the Torah. Do you see that? What about leading a flock to pasture? Isn't that what he's doing with you and me? Aren't we sheep? Is he not leading us to pasture? We look at everything that Yah does, and we have to realize one thing that my buddy Brad Scott often says that I love. Yah is a lot smarter than we are. And we should never forget that. Verse 2, he says to Moshe, "See, I have called by name Bethsael, son of Uri, son of Hur, of the tribe of Yehuda." We can see the arrangement in the name of the one called by Elohim to make the articles for the tabernacle. But I want you to notice, and I'm probably going to explain them here in a few minutes, that this man, Bethsael, is called. That's important. He's called. He's called for a specific purpose. That purpose is to make the things that Moshe was shown. Moshe was shown the pattern. Moshe is to work with this man in order to make the things for the tabernacle. So let's look. He was called. How does our calling come about? How are you and I called of Yahweh to do something? Every single person in this room, whether you realize it or not, you're called by Yahweh for a purpose. There is something He wants you to do. And you know, we have a tendency in our Greco-Western thinking to take the callings and place them in importance. For instance, I might be called to clean a bathroom. You might be called to teach. And so you think my calling is less than yours because you're a teacher and all I do is clean bathrooms. Let me assure you of one thing. If that bathroom over there didn't get cleaned, it would get pretty serious after a while. Right? So every job is important. Right? So let's not categorize Yah's calling. Whatever He's called you to do, that's what you need to do. How does it come about? Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8, and read carefully. "Do not be ashamed of the witness of our Master, nor of me, His prisoner, but suffer hardship with me for the good news according to the power of Elohim." Now look, who has saved us and called us with a set-apart calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and favor, which was given in Messiah Yahshua before times of old. Now you need to read that really carefully, because there's something in there that really should catch your attention. When did He call you? Before times of old. Not after you were born. Not when you were already doing something, but long before. He had a purpose for you and me before we were even born. From the foundation of the world, He had a purpose for you. So we have to ask ourselves, how well am I carrying that out? But first of all, what does it say? To be called, we have to be saved. Right? We have to be set apart. We have to be righteous before He calls us. Notice it says a set apart calling. Not according to our work. You say, well, I have this gift and I can do this, so I think that's what he's calling me to do. Maybe. Maybe not. See, you've got to seek him and seek his will and determine, is this just something I want to do, or is this something that he's calling me to do? And regardless of whether I want to do it or not, I need to do it because that's my calling. But again, we look at our calling sometimes and say, well, that's not a very good calling. I'm called to clean a bathroom, and this guy's called to do something really spectacular. Yahweh looks at both of you and says, both of them are spectacular. If you don't, again, believe that cleaning a bathroom is important, just let there be no toilet paper in there. You'll begin to discover how important it is. We're about to go into the Exodus one of these days, into the greater Exodus. And I'm going to tell you this, toilet paper is going to be an issue.
No, it's not.
Or the lack of it. Okay. I'm just trying to stress the importance of our calling. The text tells us that our calling was determined before times of old. When was Yeshua crucified?
The foundation.
We say, well, he was crucified there in outside of Jerusalem. And, you know, all these people witnessed it and saw it. Well, when does Yahweh say he was crucified? Before the foundation of the world. Right?
It was manifested later.
That's correct. That's a good way of saying that, by the way.
That's what the Torah says.
It was manifested. It does say that. Yeah. You know, but brother, a lot of people don't understand this word manifested. They really don't. They don't get that, as you and I know quite well. But let's look at this man who's called to do this work. Bethel means in the shadow of Elohim. His name also means in the protection of Elohim. Now this should encourage you and me, because if we're called for a purpose by Elohim, this tells me that on top of that calling, there's a shield. There's a shield of protection. And he's going to see me through whatever he's called me to do. He's going to protect me. Verse 3. He says, and I have filled him with the spirit of Elohim in wisdom and in understanding and knowledge and in all work. So what is he filled with? Let's look. But the word filled here was very interesting to me. What does it mean in English to be filled? We look at it and just means to like take a glass.
Power.
Yeah. But let's look at how Hebraically it's put. It is the word mala in Hebrew. Mala. An action word. There it is again. It's not a word, a hearing word. It's an action word. It's a verb meaning to speak. A concrete word meaning word, and an abstract meaning continue. So now if I put those things together, what do I get? It also means a continuation of segments which fill the whole. The shortened form of fill has a concrete meaning of first fruits. That was interesting. To be filled with the first fruits. But I want you to notice the continuation of segments. One of the things that I always like to talk with Yahweh about is why he just doesn't give me the whole picture. When Yahweh does through that small, still voice speak to me, he always gives it to me in segments. I've never gotten it any other way. He doesn't give it to me all at once. He gives me this little part and then another little part and connect all the parts. And I'm going to look at that a little bit further here in a moment. What I want you to grasp here, though, is talking about to continue the word to speak. Now, he created the olive bed. From the olive bed, he created everything else. He calls it the devar, to speak, and the word, right? So if I continue, how do I continue the segments that make up the olive bed? By speaking the word, right? And so this is what he did, and we'll see this applied in another place. But I really want you to grasp that he was filled with the first fruits. Who's the first fruit?
Yeshua.
Says he was filled with the Ruach HaKodesh, and he's also filled with the first fruit. The idea is that the one called is filled with the first fruit, the Ruach of Elohim. So if you are called, you are a vessel containing the first fruit, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Ruach of Elohim. So what am I saying here, and what is he trying to convey to you? What is he attempting to teach you here? That when you are called by Him, you are filled with Him with everything you need to complete the task that He's called you to. In other words, you're not empty of anything. I hear people too many times say, well, I can't do that. I don't think I can do that. Well, if He's genuinely called you, I assure you, you can do it. Because He's going to give you everything you need in order for you to do it. The infilling of the Ruach ushers in knowledge and understanding. That's a couple of things that we mentioned a while ago. My brother over here told you about. Yahweh will equip His servant to complete whatever task is assigned to him or her. So don't ever be fearful when you say, I know Yah is calling me to do this thing, but I don't know if I can. Well, if He's truly called you, the answer is yes, you can. Because He's not going to call you and then leave you with the inability to do whatever He's called you to do. So know that you have the Ruach HaKodesh. Know that you are filled with the first fruits. Know that you have everything you need to do whatever He's called you to do. I used to think, man, oh man, I couldn't get up like some of these guys do and talk in front of thousands of people. Well, may I tell you, and once I realized the calling that He put on my life to teach and to speak, I don't care if there's 100,000 people that I'm speaking to. I don't care if they're 10,000, 10,000, 100,000. I don't care. Because He is the one speaking, not me. He's the one teaching, not me. It's the Ruach HaKodesh speaking through me. And so I cannot fail. I have to succeed. Now let's take a look at the segments. I mentioned this a while ago, which fill up the whole. Now I thought this was interesting that the word fill, again, means to make whole. In Shemot chapter 31, verse 4, and 5, we begin to see the segments that are going to make up the whole. See, Yahshua doesn't give it all at one time. He gives segments. Let's look. In verse 4, to make designs for work in gold and in silver and in bronze. So those are segments. Gold, silver, and bronze. And then in the next one, and in cutting stones. This is completely different than gold and silver and bronze. Now he's got another segment of cutting stones, a stone cutter, and in carving wood. That's another segment. And to work in all work. To work in all work is really interesting. I read that and I thought, by the way, anytime you see Yah use the same word very close together like this, to work and all work, he's telling you something. Pay attention there. And decipher what he's talking about. Do you see the segments? Before I go any further, I don't want to confuse anybody. You see the segments. He doesn't just give this man in one area. He gives him these segments. He makes him so that he can work in gold and silver and bronze. He makes him so that he can be a stone cutter and set stones. He makes him a wood carver so that he can carve wood. And then to work in all work. So what does it mean to work in all work? Let's take a look. These segments are the ability to work with metal, stone, and wood. So he has the ability to do whatever needs to be done to fill the tabernacle. Notice he could also work in all work. Here is the Hebrew word, asah. To do or make something in all work means melakha. One who worked or walks for another, a messenger. Now, I want you to really grasp this. He's working in metals and stone and wood. He's going to fabricate all of the things that need to go in the temple. From tables, to the menorah, to the stones on the priest garments, everything, right? He's able to do all of that. But he also says work in all works. So what else does he need to do? It says here, melakha. Melakha means to walk for another, a messenger. So, in addition to putting together these things, he's also going to walk as a messenger of Elohim. That's another work that he's going to do. It is a work of ministry. So what he's doing here is what we would call working with our hands, but it's also being a minister and performing whatever work needs to be done. This means the one called out is expected to do something and to be a messenger for Yahweh at the same time. This just flies in the face of the religious system who says, well, I'm called to the ministry, but I don't have to do anything. Everything is already done for me. Jesus paid it all, so I don't have to do anything. I can just sit on my blessed assurance, go to church on Sunday morning, make sure I attend Easter services and Christmas candlelight service, and I'm good to go. But it means far beyond that. You would do well to leave all those things behind and do what you're supposed to do, what you're really called to do. This should be easy. Why? He's equipped you for the task. Now, I want you to stop and think about this. I watch out my kitchen window, and I watch the robins as they land in my backyard, especially after a rain or after the sprinklers have been on. And the ground is softened and the worms are making their way to the surface. Watch those robins go out and get worms. And I think to myself, now why doesn't Yahweh get those worms and take them to the robins? Okay? Why don't he open the robin's mouth and poke it down its throat? Because he expects them to do something. He provides the food for them, but they have to go get it. Why is it every miracle that I see in Scripture, they had to do something? They had to go dunk themselves 7 times, and they had to pick up their mat and walk, and they had to do all of these things. Because we are to be doers and not hearers only.
Well, the Messiah, I believe, and his father, yeah, he did everything that he did.
Good point. Absolutely. Verse 6. I look, I have appointed with him Oholiab. This is an interesting name. Son of Ahishmach of the tribe of Dan. And I put wisdom in the hearts of everyone who is wise-hearted, and they make all that I have commanded you. Some interesting things here. The name Oholiab means father's tent. The name Ahishmach means brother of support, and the root of that word means to sustain. So you begin to see the people that he calls out are some special people. By the way, are you father's tent?
Yes.
You know, we're described as living in tents. This is a tent. I have to believe that these three men, or two men rather, were chosen because of a fear of Yahweh. I do not believe any of you or me will ever be called of Yah unless we have a fear of Yahweh. This is one of the main elements of being called. Proverbs 9:10 makes it very clear. The fear of Yahweh is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the set-apart one is understanding. So these men had knowledge and understanding, which makes it very clear they were what? Men of fear. Men who feared Elohim. A wise heart. He says something about a wise heart. A wise heart is a heart that has a healthy fear of Yahweh. And it functions in the manner which they were called. They also know to follow the pattern shown them in all they do. If Yahweh calls you to do something for Him, He's going to give you a pattern. That pattern is somewhere in the Torah. If you're going to preach, He has given you a pattern of what you should preach and how you should preach it. Everything is a pattern. The segments which fill an obedient heart are the festivals, the feast days, Sabbaths, and the new moons. We that are in the Hebrew roots and have been for any length of time, we look at those things and realize how important they are. And yet there are a lot of people, even today, that are in Hebrew roots that don't put much emphasis. For instance, when he says that we're to gather on these days, a lot of people just set that aside and say, well, you know. And we do consider some feasts and festivals more important than others. Does he? All the same to him. They're all commandments that we're supposed to attend. We're supposed to be there, right? Verse 7 and following, the tent of meeting and the ark of the witness and the lid of atonement that is on it and all the utensils of the tent and the table and its utensils and the clean gold lampstand with all its utensils and the altar of incense. The altar of burnt offering with all of its utensils and the basin and its stand and the woven garments and the set apart garments for Aaron the priest and the garments for his sons for serving as priests. And the anointing oil and sweet incense for the set apart place. According to all that I have commanded you, they are to do. I hope you catch something here in that verse. According to all that I have commanded you, mm-hmm. Moses, Moshe, mm-hmm. they are to do. Mm-hmm. Yahweh tells Moshe, I've commanded you, but they are to be doers. I've given you the pattern, told you exactly what to use to make the things. Now, they are to be the doers and do it. Take note, Yahweh commanded Moshe how to construct all these things. Moshe was to delegate this knowledge to these workers and to ensure that the pattern was followed exactly. That's why at the end of that verse 11, it says, according to all that I've commanded you. In other words, you don't leave anything out. You don't take shortcuts. You don't make substitutes. You do it exactly as I have commanded you to do it. Is this important to anybody?
Oh, yes.
And Yahweh spoke to Moshe saying, and you speak to the children of Israel, saying, my Sabbaths, not the Sabbath of the Jews, my Sabbaths, plural, not just the weekly Sabbath, but the high Sabbaths as well, you are to guard by all means, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, to know that I, Yahweh, am setting you apart. There is something that really struck my heart about those verses of Scripture right there. And it has to do with our desire to keep the Sabbaths and to do what He's called us to do exactly as He's called us to do them. Let's look at this word sign. He says it's a sign for you, the Sabbaths, throughout all of your generations. We've studied this many times. The Hebrew word here, oath. An agreement or covenant by two parties. So what I want you to get a picture of here, I don't know if you ever thought about it this way. When he says, my Sabbaths are a sign between me and you throughout all of your generations. You're one party, he's the other party. And he's telling you and me that the Sabbaths are a covenant. They are a covenant between him and us.
Guiding light. It's a guiding light.
Yes. What are those two letters there? Anybody recognize those? Aleph and Tav. The Aleph Tav pictures an ox moving toward a mark. The Tav is a mark or a sign. When men used oxen to pull a plow, they fixed their eyes on a mark in order to keep the furrows straight. Now, I might appear to be a city slicker to you. When I was a young guy growing up, and I was like from about 13 years old on, I liked this farmer a lot because he had a daughter. And I really wanted to get to know his daughter. And so I'd go up and farm with him for free. And he didn't have a tractor to do plowing. He still used a mule and a plow. Now, I didn't do the plowing, but I watched an old black gentleman who was a dear friend of mine named Jack, who would plow with this mule. And I knew that Jack would look off in the distance and he'd find a post or a tree or something. And he'd line up his plow and he'd walk straight toward that. So I know exactly what this is talking about. His name was Jack Moore. Black gentleman, I thought that he was Superman. I have seen that gentleman pick up trees this big around and 6 or 8 feet long and walk them up till he could get them on his shoulder and carry them from one place to another. And he had this unique laugh. And I was just a kid, and I really admired him. So I told him, I said, Jack, you sure are strong. And he'd laugh, and he'd go, he'd laugh like that, and he'd say to me, Master Jimmy, he said, I could live more if my feet wasn't so sore. Loved him to death. Right? I learned a lot about it from him, you know, the dear gentleman. Keeping furrows straight. I think that's important when you're farming. People in the religious system claim that they are holy. Yet according to this and other verses, they lack the set apart covenant. I didn't write it. Yahweh did. Verse 14. You shall guard the Sabbath, for it is set apart for or to you. Everyone who profanes it shall certainly be put to death. For anyone who does work on it, that being shall be cut off from among his people. I got to tell you, the religious system has a major problem with this. That is one of the things you and I will run into. They'll say, well, in the Old Testament, it said if you didn't keep the Sabbath, you were to be killed. Do you still believe that you should be killed if you don't keep the Sabbath? Sure. It's in the Bible, but what does it mean? What does it mean? See? In the beginning, Yahweh created the Sabbath and commanded Israel to guard it, to shemar, to preserve and to protect it. Why? Because it's a covenant between Him and us. And it is a sign between us. But I want to show you something. Whoever profanes it, if I look at that word profanes as it appears in English, and I look at it Hebraically, it is kalal. Listen carefully. When the sin offering by transference becomes sin.
Sin leads to death.
What does that mean? If I offer something to Yah that is not according to the pattern, it's sin. So when the sin offering, for instance, if I say, well, I've got some sheep that are perfect, but I can sell them for a lot of money, and I got this one that has a slight defect, nobody will notice, so I'll take it and put it on the altar. Well, there is somebody who notices. His name is Yahweh. And your sin or trespass offering just became a sin to you. So, when he's talking about profaning it here, this is very interesting. This is why the one who profanes the Sabbath observes death. Because you have taken the Sabbath, which is set apart, Kodesh to him, Kodesh to you, and you have deliberately defiled the Sabbath. This is why they deserve death. Right? To work on the Sabbath constitutes halal. But what does the word work mean in context as used here? As he said, if you work on the Sabbath, you deserve death. Here it is, work. We just looked at it a few minutes ago. Malachat. One who walks for another, a messenger. The action meaning is to walk. The concrete meaning is a messenger. So it means to me to sin while you are representing Yahweh.
Oh.
Okay? You're His messenger. And you are delivering a false message about the Sabbath. To walk as a messenger of God, I use this intentionally, little g, or act as a deputy minister. It also means to perform labor or serve a false god. So to work for a false god, to preach a false god, to present a false god, that's the work he's talking about that deserves death. Isn't that a little different than you would have thought? So now you can answer those critics who say to you, well, back in the Old Testament, he said if you didn't keep the Sabbath, you were to be killed. No, that's not what he said. I would put it this way. If you keep the Sabbath to a false god, you need to be killed. And I think that still stands. However, we are not to perform ordinary work during the hours of Yah's Sabbath. We are to concentrate on Him. That's why we come here, to concentrate on Him. This is all about Him. It's not about us. not about our personal relationships, it's about our relationship with Him. Right? 6 days' work is done, and on the seventh is a Sabbath of rest, set apart to Yahweh. Everyone doing work on the Sabbath day shall certainly be put to death. But again, in the contextual meaning, it's anyone serving another god on the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. We've been given 6 days to do ordinary work. Six is a number associated with men. These days are given for man. The seventh is reserved for Yahweh for praise, worship, and service. The Sabbath is set apart for Israel, but it is set apart to Yahweh. Now I want you to see that. Read that carefully. The Sabbath is set apart for us, Israel, but it's set apart to Him. Okay? It's something we do, but why do we do it? To Him. It belongs to Him. It's His Sabbath. Allow me to give you what I believe to be a profaning of the Sabbath. This is just an example. And again, this is Jim 3:16. This is my opinion. This week I heard a pastor say that Romans chapter 5, verse 20 teaches that the law was specifically given to increase sin so that God could increase grace. I want to talk about that a little during our midrash today and cover that. This is what he was saying. God caused man to sin so that he could cause his grace to expand. This is a well-known pastor who has a huge ministry and a huge church, and he makes that kind of a remark. Now, I have a question. I may have it down here. I'm jumping ahead of myself. How many of you in this room believe that Yahweh needs any help at all in causing man to sin? I don't think we need any help in that regard. Do you?
No.
I think man does quite well on his own. See, we just need to ask some questions. Here's that verse, by the way. Listen carefully to the wording. If you don't understand the Hebrew, you get so lost in this. Because, well, I've used it this way. And the Torah, but law. They'll use law, not Torah. So let me read it that way. And the law came in beside so that trespass would increase. But where sin increased, favor or grace increased still more. So this is where, because of his Greco Roman, Western, Gentile thinking, he don't understand that the word law is Torah, which is the teaching and instructions of Yahweh, right? Or he would know, why did trespass increase? Because before the Torah was given, there was no recognition of sin. So the Torah is given to identify sin, right? So that the grace of Yahweh can deal with it. You understand what I'm talking about here? Question, who gave us the Torah? The law? Yahweh, right? What does the word law really mean? So, Yahweh gave us His teaching and His instruction. Is that sin?
No.
But that's what this guy is saying. He's saying that Yahweh's teaching and instructions are sin. They're to teach us how to sin. I thought they were taught to give us so that we wouldn't sin. Isn't that what the Torah teaches us? Didn't King David say, I've stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin? So, according to this pastor, Yahweh gave His teaching and instruction so more people would sin and then more people could realize His grace. I swear they just don't know what they're saying. They need to think. Oh, you recognize that Hebrew word, huh? That's a Hebrew word, baloney. Baloney. The law came to identify sin so that it could be confronted and dealt with. Mankind surely doesn't need Yah's help in committing sin. We do a splendid job of that on our own. And the children of Israel shall guard the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. Between me and the children of Israel, it is a sign forever. For in 6 days, Yah made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And when he had ended speaking with him on Mount Sinai, he gave Moshe 2 tablets of witness, tablets of stone, written with the finger of Elohim. I learned something about this too. I'm going to jump ahead here, so I'll cover it again. But how many of you in the room here saw the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston? Do you remember that God, I'm going to use their terminology, his finger appears and lightning bolts fly at the end of his finger and he carves these letters into the stone. Okay. I took that to heart. Okay. I believe that was the way it was done. Did you catch that? Yahweh completed his dialogue concerning the Sabbath and immediately turns his attention to the written Torah. He talks about the Sabbath and immediately picks up a discussion on the Torah, right? I always thought the finger of Yahweh burned the letters into the stone. That's what I saw in the movie. So Charlton Heston couldn't possibly be wrong, right? That ain't going to happen, you know? By the way, do you know that there are Jewish people in Israel who actually call Charlton Heston Moses?
Really?
Yeah, because it's portrayal of Moses. You know, that just shows you how people's brains work. They know he can't possibly be Moses. But let's look at the word finger. It's but. The finger as used for dipping into a liquid such as blood. Now when I read that and it says he wrote the Torah on those stones with his finger, to me, it means he wrote it in blood. Did Yahweh write the letters in his own blood? Could this be the sign of the blood covenant between Yahweh and his people, Israel? Could this be like a sealing of the ketubah? In his own blood. Chapter 32, moving right along. When the people saw that Moshe was so long in coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aharon and said to him, "Arise, make us mighty ones who go before us, for this Moshe, the man who brought us up out of the land of Mitzrayim, we don't even know what happened to him." How long had he been gone? 40 days, right? Most religions have looked to a mediator between themselves and their gods. You pick any of them you want to. Any religion out there. They all use mediators. We call them idols. Moshe was their mediator and now he was gone. Because of captivity for over 400 years and looking at how the Mitzrayim celebrated their idols. This is all they knew. When Pharaoh wanted to find something, he went through a mediator. Right? And the scripture tells us we have one mediator between us and Elohim. Yahshua the Messiah. Right? So we have to look at this and understand it from their point of view. They had trusted a mediator, a go-between between them and Elohim. Now all of a sudden their mediator's gone. Right? So they said, we need another mediator. We can't know what to do here without a mediator. And so they do the only thing they know to do. They look toward another mediator. Moshe had really become their idol. This is why Yah didn't want us to know where Moshe is buried. Now Aaron said to them, take off the gold earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me. And all the people took off the golden earrings which are in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he took this from their hand, and he formed it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. And they said, this is your mighty one. In other words, this is your mediator, O Yisrael, that brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. This is your God. This is your idol. This is your mediator, Israel. Israel expressed the mediator which they were most familiar with. An Egyptian idol, an ox, a calf, right? And Aaron saw and built an altar before it. And Aaron called out and said, tomorrow is a festival to Yahweh. We now have a new mediator, so now we can build an altar and have a festival to Yahweh. What's happening here? Aaron built an altar to sacrifice before the golden calf on the next day and declared it a festival to Yahweh. False worship always substitutes the feast days and festivals. In fact, this is what the anti-Messiah does. How do we know that? Because it tells us in Dan, book of Dan, Daniel, Chapter 7, verse 25. And it, the anti-Messiah, speaks words against the Most High and wears out the set apart ones of the Most High and intends to change the appointed times, that's the festivals, and the law to lawlessness. And they are given into his hand for a long time, or for a time, and times and half a time, which is 3.5 years. So, notice there, speaks word against the Most High. Do you realize when people say we don't have to keep those feasts and festivals, they're not for us, they're speaking against the Most High? Yep. It says it wears out the set apart ones of the Most High. If we're not careful, we'll allow them to talk us down, talk us out of keeping the feasts and festivals that we're supposed to be keeping. This is what the anti-Messiah does. And he wants to change the feast days and make us lawless. That's his goal. And they rose early on the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. And Yahweh said to Moshe, go, get down. For your people whom you brought out of the land of Mitzrayim have corrupted themselves. The people had corrupted themselves. That is, they brought destruction upon themselves. They chose death over life. They chose it, not Yahweh. He didn't choose it for them.
Did one thing back there? As Yah said, the people you brought out,
you brought out. They turned aside quickly out of the way I commanded. Let's stop there and talk about us. What did we do? We turned aside out of the way which he commanded us. We turned to man's tradition, man's Torah. We began to celebrate feasts and festivals outside of what Yah had commanded us to do. We began to talk about a gospel without even realizing what the gospel is. Our mentality was it was Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Actually had nothing to do with that. Then it says, they have made themselves a molded calf and have bowed themselves to it and slaughtered to it and said, this is your mighty one, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. Trust me, when we substitute anything for the feast and festivals and the Sabbath, we are doing exactly that. We've bowed down to something different and we've made that our sacrifice. Right? I mean, we really have to face truth. And truth is sometimes a hard pill to swallow. But if we don't swallow it and pay heed to it, we're going to pay a terrible price. The people turned aside from the way. The word there is direct, which means a course of life or a mode of action. So it is the walk of the Torah and how you conduct yourself. The people turned from life to death. And Yahweh said to Moshe, I have seen this people, and see, it is a stiff-necked people. And now, listen to the words of Yahweh here. Now, Moshe, let me alone, that my wrath might burn against them, and I consume them and make of you a great nation. Mm-hmm. When Moshe hears these words, if a lot of people today heard those words, here's what they'd think. Wow, what a deal. I could just let him wipe all those people out, and I will become the substitute for Abraham. Now all the promises made to Abraham are going to be mine. Instead of a great nation being formed from Abraham, it'll be formed from me. So kill them all, get rid of them. This would have been the attitude of many people, right?
Still is.
The phrase, let me alone, lets us know something special. That Yahweh left Israel's future in Moshe's hands. He could have done it without saying, let me alone. He didn't need Moses' permission, right? So we have to ask ourselves, this is why I say asking questions is important. When you read these things, why did he tell Moses to leave me alone? What could Moshe do to stop Elohim? Not a thing if he really wanted to do something. So it tells us something. It tells us that he's leaving Israel's future. He said, now Moshe, you can take this upon yourself. And I'll make you as Abraham. I'll substitute you for Abraham. And I'll make of you a great nation. We can start all over from ground zero. Had he done or said nothing, Moshe would have become the new Abraham. But Moshe pleaded with Yahweh, his Elohim, and said, Yahweh, why does your wrath burn against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Mitzrayim, with great power and with a strong hand? And wait a minute. Yahweh just told Moshe, these people whom you brought out of Mitzrayim. Right? Now what? Moshe is reminding, it wasn't me. You're the one who brought them out of Mitzrayim. Okay? Why should the Mizraites speak and say, for evil he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from the heat of your wrath and relent from this evil to your people. All he's doing is reminding Yahweh of the promises Yahweh had made. This is how we're supposed to pray.
For your name's sake.
Exactly. It's for your name's sake. You know, it's a good point, Trish, because Moshe is saying, hey, this is not going to affect me one way or the other. But the Mizraites over there, it's going to affect you. It's going to affect your glory and your esteem. This is about you, not about me. Right? And really and truly, this is the things that we need to remind Moshe. When later on today we pray for Israel, be careful to remember the promises made to Israel by Yahweh. It's not a thing wrong with saying, wait a minute. Abba, you said this and you said that and you said the other concerning Israel. You can't allow this to happen. You know, this goes against your word. He wants to hear that, by the way. Because why? Lets him know that you know his word. Moshe was simply using remnants to save his people. He uses the word of Yahweh, pointing out the promises Yahweh had given to Israel. And also reminding him, hey, don't blame me for this. You're the one brought them out of Israel, not me. Okay? I couldn't possibly do this. What does Yeshua tell us? Apart from me, you can do nothing. Remember Abraham, Yitzhak, and Israel, your servants to whom you swore by yourself and said to them, I increase your seed like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of I give to your seed, and they shall inherit forever. Moshe said, how are you going to do that if you kill all of them? You made this promise to them, now you're talking about wiping them all out. How's this going to ever happen? You know what? Yahweh already knew he wasn't going to destroy Israel. Right? And Yahweh relented from the evil which he said he would do to his people. You know, I was talking to some Mormon missionaries several years ago. And they told me, they said, there's one place in the Bible where it says that Yahweh himself repented. And this is the verse they quoted. Not repented, it's relented. There's a difference between repenting and relenting.
Really?
Until next we meet, study to show yourselves approved.
Yeah, who's the one who wrote Torah? How do you return to Torah?